finding any entertainment that isn't fat-phobic is a nightmare. And why hasn't the believability of fat suits improved since the 90s?
Why can't you just cast a show with a funny fat actress?
Because Melissa McCarthy and Rebel Wilson weren't available.
They're not the only fat actresses.
Are you insane?
No,
I'm just fat and also happy. Why is that so hard for you to understand?
Will you please welcome Rosie Waterland. So, I know a lot of people have sort of fallen in love with you because of your views on The Bachelor.
Yes.
Are you, like, the original obsessive Batch fan? Is that how you came to this?
I'm the original obsessive Osh's hair fan.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen you tweeting about the hair. What is it about the hair that so enamours you?
I think it's just a glorious crown atop the head of a legend of network television who, by the way, has been robbed of a gold Logie so far, if I do say so myself.
Oh, are you starting the campaign now?
Oh, he started it years ago. I just help out where I can. Yeah.
So you are a bachelor obsessive, so I'm wondering, you've probably got a perfect bachelor and a perfect bachelorette in your dream episodes. So who would you like to see in those roles?
Look, until I saw that display with the kebab, I probably would have said Tommy. Although I have heard that you don't have trouble dating, what, 20 women at once?
No, so no.
That's not fair. He definitely has trouble dating. No.
And then I reckon Susie, huh?
Yeah,
Susie. What? Here we go.
I mean, that's ridiculous. Sorry, that's Network 10 calling me out. I'm fired.
I just love how you bring your earphone on set.
Rosie, you have written a bunch of books. You absolutely love your writing. For anyone who's fallen in love with you through the Bachelor recaps, they would be a little bit surprised at the content in your books about your life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I had a tricky childhood, and that's what my books are about. And I think people bought my books thinking it was just going to be 500 pages about Osh's hair. And then, you know, I talked about my drug addict parents and being in and out of the foster system and growing up struggling with that kind of abuse and trauma. But I don't know how to not put a joke on every page. So, also funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I promise.
It's a big turn.
Be a bit insufferable otherwise.
Well, also when people, I imagine people going, oh, where's all the hair
Yeah,
stuff?
I know. But they already bought it, so sucker.
did you think twice about putting this stuff down on paper, though?
Look, not really. I think it was hugely important and empowering to finally be able to own my own narrative in that way, to grow up in a childhood where you have no control over anything, where you'll live, where you'll be. I mean, I went to 20 schools. Like, my mum was a sex worker and one day just decided she wanted a holiday, so she married one of her clients who lived in Hawaii. And then when she was done, we just came home. It was just a nice few months on the beach, you know what I mean? Wow. So when you have that much lack of control, there's something really empowering about being able to sit down and say what happened to you and take control of your story.
And have a lot of people come to you and said, look, I never knew this about you since?
Yeah. I've had a few people crying in the freezer aisle at Coles. But it's
I'm
nice.
Really sorry about that,
yeah,
by
I
the
know.
Way.
I wasn't going to bring it up then. Yeah, you know, but it's nice. And I think it helps people to have someone talking about this stuff, but also talking about it in a way that kind of proves it doesn't have to define your life. I mean, I use it to tell jokes and make money now, so it defines my life in that way. But, but you know, I'm doing quite well out of it. So I think that's the best message there is.
So, can I just ask what your mum thinks about the memoir? Because that's her life that you've put out there.
Yes. So I never thought she'd read it because she was drinking a lot and I just didn't think she'd have the capacity to, but then she got sober and she read it.
I hate when people get sober.
I know. And she didn't like it. So she said I made it all up. She struggled with a lot of the stuff I revealed. So then I said to her, well, I'm always a performer and always a content creator, so let's do a podcast about that. So we started a podcast called Mum Says My Memoir Is a Lie, and it's basically where I read each chapter and we talked about what she thought I was making up. And she says, well, you were a kid, and I said, well, you were drunk, and that's kind of where we landed. But, you know, it's been downloaded almost 7 million times. Jeez. So I think people, you know, whether you had the traumatic childhood that I had or not, there's something about disagreeing with your parents about what went on when you were growing up that appeals, clearly.
Yeah. Well, you can find out more by seeing Rosie's new comedy show, Kid Chameleon, that kicks off in February next year. We've got all the details on our website. Would you please thank Rosie Waterland?
Well, that is about all we've got time for tonight. Would you please thank Lisa Wilkinson, Tommy Little and Susan Yusek.